Good afternoon. I am Tosca Bruno van Vijwijken and I work at the Transnational NGO Initiative here at the Maxwell School. I'm here today with Professor Patrice McMahon, who is an associate professor at the University of Nebraska at Lincoln. Thank you for visiting us today and thank you for allowing us to interview you today. I just wanted to get a little bit of sense of your research. How would you describe the nature of your research, Professor McMahon?
My research looks at the role of non-governmental organizations in post-conflict countries, and it focuses mostly on the Balkans, but I look at other countries as well. So I'm really interested in what NGOs do and how effective they are in trying to help post-conflict countries.
What is specific about the post-conflict sector and how NGOs engage with it, you think, that makes it so interesting to you?
Well, you know, I first became interested in this research when I went to Bosnia in 2000, and I was very surprised and impressed by all of the non-governmental organizations. And I wanted to understand why NGOs had arrived in such numbers in the Balkans in the late 1990s, and I also wanted to see how effective they were.
I see. Are you part of a university center or institute or department that collectively focuses on transnational NGOs, or are you more like a sole researcher investigating this?
Well, there are a couple of us that are interested in non-governmental organizations in different ways, and I'm in the Department of Political Science, and we have a research group that looks at human security.
I see.
And so one of the faculty members looks at women's organizations in Africa, and another woman looks at human rights organizations, but we, you know, we define our group as human rights and conflict.
I see.
All focus broadly on human security.
Okay, so that is the critical mass that you formed together. How did you personally first become interested in these non-state actors and in transnational activism? Do you have any background being in activism yourself, or are you purely academically interested in it?
When I was in graduate school in Washington, D.C., I started working for the German Marshall Fund in the early 1990s, and that's about the time that the German Marshall Fund became involved in democracy promotion activities in Central and Eastern Europe, and my family is from Poland, so I did some work with the German Marshall Fund, and then on my own, some research with women's organizations in Central and Eastern Europe, in Russia and in Poland. And so that's when I became really interested in kind of the NGO boom in Central and Eastern Europe and post-communist countries. And then later went back to do some work in the Balkans.
I see. It's interesting that you come from a practitioner background and then moved into academia. It's lovely to see that. Within your field of research, NGOs, at least this field, I know you have a couple of other research interests, but of NGOs in conflict settings, which core challenges do you see, especially transnational or international NGOs, have to address at the moment? And what are their strengths as well as their weaknesses in addressing these challenges?
Well, I think international NGOs are facing a lot of challenges. So let me just talk about kind of the research part, because you noted that I was a practitioner working for an international NGO and then an academic. And I think one thing that we all know who work on NGOs is there's not enough information about what NGOs do. So international NGOs that are doing really good work, sometimes we don't know enough about their work. And and it's very hard for them to improve their work if we don't have a lot of lessons learned and a lot of research on NGOs. So I think that that's one of the challenges. Is it still hard for NGOs themselves? And I think Thomas Carruthers, when he was in one of his writings, was talking about, you know, NGOs, the people who are practitioners are busy working. They don't have time to reflect and ask all these questions. So I think there needs to be more collaboration between academics and researchers and practitioners. And I also think in a different way, international NGOs are really challenged because there are so many contractors, for-profit contractors that have emerged in the last decade. And so I think NGOs are already changing some of their strategies and how they approach issues, because there's this whole new group of non-state actors who are not principled actors. Really, their goal for the most part, and not all of them, is really about making money. So I think they're being challenged in terms of what makes an international NGO or a transnational NGO different from a non-state actor, because both of them may be interested or involved in human rights, but they really approach things differently.
Yeah, that's interesting. Let me also ask you, you already mentioned that the amount of information and data on international NGOs is quite weak. It's something that you and we and others are trying to work on. What areas of research related to transnational or international NGOs do you feel are under-examined that you wish to direct both researchers and students their attention to?
Yeah, I think for me what I struggle with a lot is assessment. And I think a lot of people struggle with assessing who does what where. Mm-hmm. We know, I think, why they do. You know, international NGOs are active in certain areas or in certain countries. I think That's obvious. But trying to assess effectiveness of individual NGOs and then as a group is really challenging. And I think we're getting, you know, we're moving in the right direction. And mm-hmm. I think people who do qualitative work or are working with people who do quantitative work and practitioners, certainly NGOs in Washington have opened their books to me to look at their programs and their activities and who they work with. So I think there's people on both sides and in lots of different areas that really want to understand kind of outcomes and assess international NGOs better. But I think that's still an area that really needs a lot more research.
Yeah, that's, I would totally agree with that and also say that we also try to do some work on that. Now, if we look a little bit further down into the future, in terms of forecasting, what is the one issue you feel as being critical for transnational NGOs to address in the medium to long term? Mm-hmm. And within that issue, what are some of the organizational challenges that we here in the TNGO initiative particularly are interested in? What organizational aspects do you see to that need to be part of that?
Yeah, I think one of the things that I talk about a lot in my research is the decoupling of kind of what international NGOs want to do and what happens on the ground, and I mean kind of decoupling from other processes, that there are domestic processes that are working and international NGOs go in to promote women's groups or human rights groups. And sometimes as a result of the way in which the international communities have to behave because mm-hmm. they're an organization, sometimes the unintended consequence of that is there's this lack of, as your word, of rootedness of groups who may have the same goals and the same interests, but they maybe can work, the international can work well with the local groups, but the local groups as a result forget about or fail to develop their own domestic constituency or what I call a domestic advocacy core. They need to have people who they're really reflecting, reacting to, and responding to. So I think what I call it is it's almost a civil society that is disembedded. And so that's really an issue that I think international NGOs have to think about is why local NGOs sometimes are not very vibrant and not very sustained in a domestic context without international dollars and international support.
For those NGOs, this will be my last question, that you have seen developing an awareness about this disembeddedness, as you call it. What have they done as organizations to try to strengthen their roots in local society?
Well, and I think there are really good examples of that, and I brought up one today of CRS. Yeah. I think they do research. They try to assess what they've done, what they wanted to do, and then they retool. And they say, we're going to do things differently and we can improve. So I think organizations that are really reflective and thoughtful about what they do and why they're doing things have been able to change this dynamic and been able to restructure things.
And can you just mention a couple of the things that would be in the retooling kit, if you will, a couple of directions that they probably would have to move into?
I think one is listening more. And, you know, I brought up this phrase that's used a lot in the Balkans of, you know, copy, cut, and delete or something like that, right? So instead of going into countries with a real set idea of what the international NGO wants to accomplish, I think going in with the idea that they want to be helpful in a very broad and general way and then figuring out how they can be best helpful depending on the domestic context is one way, a strategy. Another strategy is to constantly kind of, and I know assessment costs money and takes time, but to say, okay, we'll work in this way using this approach for 3 years and then come back and reassess how things are going. So I think going there without a real firm idea, constantly retooling and assessing things, and then also really investing in the local population and hiring people, not just to do staff work, but being in charge of offices.
Right, right.
And I've seen a lot of international NGOs do that, go from being, you know, internationally led and organized and directed to becoming really a domestic NGO. That's
right.
the person in charge is a person from that country.
Right.
So I think I've seen that over time, too, right. Realizing the importance of having rootedness and being an endogenous organization.
Well, thank you so much for this interview, and thank you for visiting us
thank
today
you.
At the Moynihan
Institute. It's been great. Thank you.